Amen. The Lord is so good, isn't He? And I want to turn your attention this morning to one of the most beautiful of the New Testament letters. It's Paul's letter to the Philippians. As I share with you on our fellowship in the gospel. This letter is particularly endearing and appealing, not only for what it contains, but also, I feel, for what is noticeably absent. It's a little different to the other letters that Paul wrote, because with this letter, there's no correction, there's no reprimand, there's no reproof. They are not a church where there appears to have been problems doctrinally or morally. And so Paul is writing to them this letter, which is somewhat unique. I've always regarded this really as a love letter. The apostle, full of love for God's people, whom he had been instrumental in seeing brought to Christ through the gospel there in Philippi. And just in this first chapter, notice how he speaks. He says, I remember you with thanksgiving to God. He says, I always pray for you with joy. He says, I know that God is working in you and He is going to finish that work which He has begun. That's encouraging, isn't it? Amen. He hasn't finished with us yet. He is continuing His work until He brings us to where He has purposed. Hallelujah. And there's something within this apostle's heart. It's a yearning that can only be expressed in terms of that Christ-like affection. So that he says something to this effect, my passion is to see you taken up with those things which are most excellent. Don't just be content with what is mediocre in spiritual things, but go for what is the best, so that you may abound with those fruits of righteousness which are to the praise and the glory of God. Wonderful passion and wonderful desires and wonderful prayers Paul prays in respect of the saints. And he also says, I long to see you advance in joy. Something about this letter, not only love, but there's joy, and there's hope, and there's peace. He wants to see this people profiting in divine and spiritual things, and especially, of course, in that full knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ. What a letter this is. And I've been blessed as I've come to it again. It's so precious to see the things that Paul touches on here that reflect something of the character of this church in Philippi. Really, it's a church to be envied. A church that's happy and harmonious. And I want to say, friends, that in local assembly life, that is to be treasured and it's to be preserved. There is, of course, in chapter 4, if you'll turn to chapter 4 and verse 2, Paul has heard something that does concern him, especially because of his shepherd's heart. And he says, I beseech Euodias and Syntyche that they be of the same mind in the Lord. Now, who these two ladies were, we are not told, but it appears that there was some disagreement that had crept in. There it had arisen between them that was not conducive to that wholesome and profitable fellowship as a local church, and particularly too in respect of the extension of the gospel. As I was meditating, I began to wonder if we really do realize how crucial our attitudes and our relationships are within the local assembly. Or that they may be as they should be, using the expression of Paul here to these two ladies, in the Lord. Because if they are not as they should be in the Lord, there is an adverse outcome in our fellowship in respect of our unity, and also, I believe, the effectiveness of our witness. I could not help but recall the words of David in his Psalm 51 and verse 10. I know it's a totally different context because he had sinned grievously against the Lord. But the essence of this prayer of his, he says, "Oh, create in me a clean heart, O God. And listen, renew a right spirit within me." He's praying for a renewing of the inward man. That increase of God's grace in the life that makes for that God-pleasing, righteous quality of being. That constant and upright spirit. And if we are to know unity and to know God's blessing and effectiveness of a fellowship, a local fellowship, then we need that kind of a heart. Now, you will notice there are two things that seem to stand out in the epistle if you were to read through it, and we will touch upon it this morning. But two things, that of fellowship and that of the gospel. These appear to be prominent in the mind of Paul throughout the letter. There's the helpfulness of the fellowship. And there is the hopefulness of the gospel. So let's just take a look for a moment in chapter 1 at verses 3 to 5. Where Paul says, "I thank my God upon every remembrance of you, always in every prayer of mine for you all, making request with joy for your fellowship in the gospel from the first day until now." Notice those two words again, fellowship and gospel, because they are repeated many times in the letter. And before I direct you to some specific references, let's remember that the true church, the true local church, is a fellowship that has its roots in the gospel, what Paul describes down in verse 27 as the gospel of Jesus Christ. Our local assembly here, friends, it's not just a club. We don't gather just for some social interaction. It's a fellowship. And I trust that we will be able to appreciate something of what that means. But here is Paul as he's thinking about this church. You know where the church started? In a little prayer meeting down by the riverside. A few ladies were gathered for prayer, fervently seeking God. And may I say this morning, with regards to the local fellowship, anything worthwhile in the local church will always find its origin in the prayer meeting. That is, in the place of prayer. Yes, our own private times where we are seeking God, as well as when we come together. I was so pleased. I only wish I could be here on Fridays to share with you in the prayer fellowship, because that is so vital for us in the local church. Because the place of prayer is the place of revelation. It's the place of spiritual renewal. And I would exhort you this morning, friends, never despise the day of small things. It may just be a little prayer meeting by the riverside, but oh, what God did. Just let us believe for greater things. And so here is Paul writing to this group of people in Philippi. He thinks back to those simple but fruitful beginnings of his ministry there in Philippi. And in the congregation, there was no doubt Lydia, the woman who was actually from Thyatira. I am with the time just to pause to mention what I feel is very precious with regards to her. She was a business lady. And she used to come down to Philippi, and there she would fulfill her business and earn her living. And you know, Paul had been wanting to go to Bithynia. And if he had been going to Bithynia, no doubt he would have gone through that very area where she came from. But Paul said, no, not on this occasion, Paul. Macedonia, Philippi. And it seems as though the Lord gives him a little compensation. One of the first converts was from the place he wanted to go to. God is just like that, isn't he? So there is this woman, Lydia, this businesswoman from Thyatira. And there's the jailer who had been so marvelously converted through the faithful witness of Paul and Silas. And no doubt there was also a young woman in that church who had been a demonized woman, but marvelously delivered by the power of God. As Paul was given that spirit of discernment and saw that which troubled her, and set her gloriously free. Praise the Lord. This lovely little church in Philippi, people of different walks and backgrounds and characteristics. But here they are together by the grace of God through the gospel, now in fellowship. And that is why Paul has such joy, because he has seen something of God's saving work in them, as we have known it in us as believers, signifying the transforming power of this gospel we've come to know and to understand by the help of the Holy Spirit. In fact, this gospel is referred to 9 times in this very brief letter, in which Paul touches on a number of aspects. As we have noted in chapter 1 and verse 5, he talks about this fellowship in the gospel, a fellowship that's enjoyed by all true believers. When I come into this assembly from time to time, oh, there's something refreshing, something so precious, because this is a fellowship in the gospel, because this is where we find the common interest this morning. After the service, we will have a cup of coffee. Now, that can be a time of personal fellowship, but not necessarily so. It can just be a little social time. But here we are gathered this morning as a local fellowship in the interest of the gospel. This is the common factor. We have known something of the dynamic of the gospel in our lives. We know something of the demands of the gospel, and by the grace of God, we are reaching out to attain to what God has purposed for us in Christ. And oh, there's that revelation that has been received concerning the destiny of the gospel, because he has called us to glory and to virtue. And so in this verse 5, Paul says, listen, there is the fellowship of the gospel. And in verse 7, he talks about being set for the defense and confirmation of the gospel. Here is Paul's passion, seeking to establish the truth of the gospel. The gospel is not just simply, oh, come to Jesus. Raise up your hand if you want to know Jesus as your Savior. Listen, oh, the gospel, how it needs to be expounded more and more. And here's Paul, the confirmation of the gospel. It's the establishing of its truth in believers, as well as for the proclamation of its truth by believers. And that's our job in the work of the ministry, establishing people in the truth of what the gospel is all about. It's not only being brought to Christ, it is growing up into Christ to be like him more and more. And then notice in verse 12, he talks about the furtherance of the gospel. And with the Apostle Paul, even through his imprisonment and his sufferings for Christ's sake. No, the world and the devil could not stop the progress of this mighty church and of the gospel. Even with the sufferings, there was the furthering of the gospel. And we, friends, I believe, can spread its influence in manifesting God's grace at all times, especially in our times of trial and the many troubles that beset us, all that others might see the grace of God in us and know something of what the gospel has done in our lives, that will be an effective witness even to them, the furtherance of the gospel. And not only in verse 7, but down to verse 17, again he speaks about being set for the defense of the gospel. That is Paul answering those who question it, taking a firm stand for its truth, despite all the difficulties and the discouragements in the way, defending it from corruption and declaring it with conviction and with unction, the defense of the gospel. And go down to verse 27. Because here, Paul touches now upon the living out of the gospel. Those lives that are seen to be worthy of all that the gospel represents. Listen to him. Only let your conversation, your conduct, your manner of life be as it becomes the gospel of Jesus Christ. That whether I come to see you or be absent, whether I'm there or not, that I may hear of your affairs, that you stand fast in one spirit. Our lives, friends, must be seen to be consistent with our Christian profession. All that the gospel represents should be seen in the way that we live, in our personal lives, in the workplace, in the home, as well as in the fellowship of the church. Will you note it? It's not just, friends, what we have received. Thank God for grace. But it's what also we have renounced. I've been challenged in recent times, taking our midweek fellowship back up at Landsborough in the great theme of godliness. and how challenged I was by what Peter has to say in his second epistle, chapter 1, and verses 3 and 4. According as His divine power has given unto us all things that pertain unto life and godliness. Listen, God has given to us all that we shall ever need in order to attain to His purpose of being godly, worthy representatives of this gospel. Through the knowledge of Him that hath called us to glory and virtue. Listen now, whereby are given unto us exceeding great and precious promises, right in this gospel, that is, that by these you might be partakers of the divine nature. That's the one part of it. Having received of that divine nature. But more than that, what's he say? Having forsaken, you've run away from, you've renounced that corruption that's in the world through lusts. This is the Christian, friends. He's not only received something that makes for a new life, but it is that which he has renounced because it was his old life. That's the Christian. And there's no other kind of Christian, really. True Christian, I mean, who has come to know something, partaking of that divine nature, and having renounced that world with all its lustings. This new life that we have of God in Christ. So Paul talks about letting our conversation, our manner of life, be as it becomes the gospel of Christ. Living out the gospel. And then just go over to chapter 4 and verse 3, because Paul there speaks about laboring together with others in the interests of spreading the gospel. Whether it be in our community, or thank God this morning for the outreach of this fellowship. And the reminder this morning, there is a ministry being fulfilled there in Bangladesh with David and Alice Campbell. Precious servants of God. And you are seeking to support them with your giving and with your prayers. It's all in the interest of the furthering of the gospel of Jesus Christ. Praise the Lord. Laboring together with others. And notice in verse 27, striving together. This is in chapter 1, verse 27. Striving together for the faith of the gospel. You see, Paul knew that there will always be an assault upon that grace of faith by the trinity of evil, the world, and the flesh, and the devil. That which seeks to undermine our faith, to weaken our faith. That's why really what he is saying to these people is what he said to the Ephesians. Listen, be strong in the Lord. He says to this church, I want you to be strong in faith, to stand fast in this faith of the gospel. Like Abraham, as I was reminded of him, and it was Paul who set forth Abraham as an example in Romans chapter 4 and verses 20 to 21, saying, he staggered not at the promise of God through unbelief. He was strong in faith. Strong through faith, giving glory to God. Listen to it. Being fully persuaded that what God had promised, he was able also to perform. There was nothing that could move Abram away from his hope and from that which he knew God had purposed. What's it say? The promise of God through unbelief. No, he staggered not, but was strong in or through faith. Literally, it put power into his faith. How? Was it by clenching the fist and gritting the teeth? Thank you for that lovely hymn this morning. Jesus, I am struggling. No, Jesus, I am resting in the joy of who you are. Oh, praise the Lord. We have ceased, friends, from that struggle as we come to see that all we have, all we ever hope to be, is by grace through faith. So here is Abraham, not gritting his teeth and saying, well, I hope I can make it. No, what's it say? Being fully persuaded that what God had promised, he was able also to perform. He reminds himself, and I'm sure he did it many times, of God's word of promise. It's the word, friends, that bolsters our faith. Faith not only comes, it not only originates with the word, it's sustained by the word. And I believe also that this is where we can assist one another. I don't mean by that going around preaching at people and proclaiming some special word that we've got for them in their time of difficulty. Although we may certainly have something that will help them from God's word. I was in America at one time, had a wonderful meeting. I'd been preaching for quite a while, expounding in the Epistle to the Romans, and people had met at the altar to seek God, and we were there for an hour or so, just waiting upon God. Then the pastor said, well, I think it's time for us just to go home. And his lovely little wife, she came up to me and she said, Pastor, do you have a word from the Lord for me? I said, no. She said, I thought you didn't. I mean, I've been preaching for an hour and a half. Word from the Lord. There it was. But oh, how we can be a means of encouragement and strength to one another in our fellowship in the gospel. That people who are going through times of difficulty, they may remain strong through faith, because again we encourage them that what God has promised, he is able to fulfill. Praise the Lord. And I want you just to turn to Colossians chapter 3 for a moment. I think there is an appropriate passage there that will link with this. In Colossians chapter 3, verses 14 to 17, where Paul now is exhorting that church, he says, listen, and put on love. This is where it begins. Put on love, he says, which is the bond of perfectness. Love is the girdle that binds us together. This holy love is the bond of union between us. That which knits us, that which cements us together, so we might be perfectly joined together, being of one mind, of one heart. And notice what he says in verse 15. And let the peace of God rule in your hearts, to the which also you are also called in one body. Here's the body. Here's the local fellowship. and be thankful. Verse 16, let the word of Christ dwell in you richly in all wisdom, teaching and admonishing one another in psalms and hymns, yes, and spiritual songs, singing with grace in your hearts to the Lord. And in verse 17, whatsoever you do in word or in deed, do all in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God and the Father by him. Hallelujah. How marvelous, friends, this gospel and the faith of the gospel. We might remain strong as we stand fast in that which God has not only revealed to us, but what he has accomplished in us. In fact, as I was again meditating, this is what the Lord's table is all about this morning. It has to do with the purpose and the proposal and the power and the personal impact of the gospel of Christ, which the power of God and to salvation to all who believe. We know it this morning. Christ died for our sins according to the scriptures. He was buried. He rose again from the dead on the third day according to the scriptures. Oh, that means so much to us. We've celebrated it this morning. It's the faith of the gospel of Christ. In his letter to Timothy, Paul refers to it as the glorious gospel of our blessed God, which was committed, he says, to my trust. Or perhaps more correctly translated, the gospel of the glory of God and of our Savior, Jesus Christ. Thank God, friends, for his saving gospel this morning. The one who gave himself for us, without which cross work and resurrection, there would be no gospel. And so Paul rejoices in the power of the gospel. He rejoices as he looks upon that little group of believers in Philippi, the fruit of the gospel, those changed lives united in Christ, no longer at enmity with God, but right with God, and joined together in a wondrous fellowship with others of like precious faith. That's why I feel at home this morning with God's people here. People of like precious faith. We know this fellowship in the bonds of the gospel. Dinah was talking to the daughter of Harold Bartholomew last week in a funeral we attended. And in course of conversation, made mention of dear Willie Burton, that wonderful missionary to the Congo. And I recall being at a convention preaching in Wakefield in the north of England. And on the Monday was always missionary day, and a number of missionaries would be present and sharing their vision and stirring the hearts of people in respect of missions. And Willie Burton was there as one of the guests. And between the services, we were just chatting together. In fact, we were standing on the steps of that very imposing building. Because when you stood on the steps, the long steps going up into the church, you looked out. Or the immediate view was the cattle yards. That wasn't very, wonderful to look at. But you know, as we just stood there, it seems as though he was looking far beyond the cattle yards. And then he paused and said to me, this rookie preacher, this stalwart of a missionary, to me an apostle of Jesus Christ. And he said, what was the greatest thing that God created? Well, what was I going to say to that man? But before I could even venture an answer, he said, fellowship. There's something, friends, about fellowship. There's fellowship in the gospel. Look at this first letter. And this morning, just an outline, and maybe I will come to expound a bit more about this another time, if you'll have me back. But in verse 5, notice in chapter 1, there's the fellowship in the gospel. In fact, in Ephesians chapter 3 and verse 9, Paul refers to it as the fellowship of the mystery which from the beginning of the world has been hid in God, who created all things by Jesus Christ. The fellowship of this mystery, the mystery of the gospel, a fellowship in the gospel. When he writes to the Corinthians, 1 Corinthians 1 and verse 9, he says, you are called unto the fellowship of his Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. And when he writes to the Galatians in chapter 2 and verse 9, Paul says, when James and Peter and John, who seem to be pillars, that is, pillars in the church, when they perceived the grace of God that was given unto me, both the grace of calling and the grace of commission, they gave to me and to Barnabas the right hands of fellowship that we should go to the heathen. Hallelujah. Then notice, it's not only the fellowship in the gospel and in the interest of the gospel, it's a fellowship of the Spirit. Chapter 2 and verse 1. If there be any consolation in Christ, if any fellowship of the Spirit. The marvelous thing about each one of us this morning as believers, there's been a wonderful work of the Holy Spirit in us, transforming us, changing us, converting us, regenerating us, and day by day, I trust, sanctifying us. And this wonderful Holy Spirit has joined us together as one. There's a fellowship of the Spirit that we know this morning that is so glorious and precious. And then down to in chapter 3 and verse 10, marvelous expression of Paul's heart and the things that he longs to know, amongst which is the fellowship of Christ's sufferings. But not just the sufferings, of the triumph too. The fellowship of his sufferings, the power of his resurrection being made conformable unto his death. Maybe that's an aspect of fellowship we don't really relish. The fellowship of his sufferings. But it's there. If we are going to be true followers of Jesus Christ, it will be down a path of suffering of some kind for his name's sake. No, friends, that's not talking about having the flu. It's when we are persecuted for righteousness' sake. And there may be here some this morning here in this fellowship. It's not been easy for you, even with your family. And you've known something of their antagonism because you've come to faith in Christ. And you have suffered for Christ's sake. And this is part of this fellowship. This fellowship in the gospel. The fellowship of Christ's sufferings and triumph. Thank God for that. And there's this fellowship in Christian service. In chapter 4 and verse 3, where Paul says, listen, we are fellow laborers. I like that, don't you? Fellow laborers. We are working together because together with the same interest at heart. There is this common factor with us. We believe this gospel. And we know that Christ has commissioned us to spread it wherever we can. And together we can labor. Praise the Lord. There's a wonderful fellowship that we enjoy this morning in the gospel. Are you glad for the gospel? You don't sound very convinced. Are you glad for the gospel? Do you treasure this fellowship in the gospel this morning? The local assembly. Let's do all we can, friends, to promote its unity, its harmony, its joy, its effectiveness, that God might be glorified in us. Hallelujah. Lord, please bless our thoughts this morning as they've centered upon your gospel, upon the glorious gospel, the gospel of the glory of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ. Pray, Lord, that we will go on to have an increasing appreciation for all that the gospel means. And help us, Lord, today to be living out its truth, that others might see the grace of God. Even as Paul refers to James and Peter, who perceived the grace of God in him and Barnabas. Oh, that others will see the grace of God in us and come to know you as we have. Glorify the Lord Jesus Christ, I pray. Amen.